Welcome to this Creation Health presentation on Outlook. Our seminar theme is Living Life to the Fullest, which according to John 10:10 is exactly what God wants for our lives. An optimistic outlook helps us to get the most out of life. It's essential to health, happiness, and abundance. Outlook is also a gift we give to ourselves. A negative outlook turns off the lights of hope. It changes love into hate and peace into stress. A positive outlook does the opposite. It brings hope, ignites love, and sets hearts ablaze. A positive outlook is available through the power of our Creator. Positive is what He made us to be, positive and full of hope. Outlook is the seventh principle in the Creation Health acronym. It's one of the eight universal teachings that God gave for enjoying life as He designed. During this presentation, we'll see how having an optimistic outlook and living with a positive approach to life impacts our health. Each of us chooses how we will live, pessimistic or optimistic. So let's consider the science behind these two very different orientations as we continue our journey toward whole person wellness.
When Apollo 13 thundered to life in an eruption of fire at liftoff, no one knew its crew would need a miracle to make it back home from the moon. 55 hours into the mission, two oxygen tanks exploded, ripping a hole in the side of the rocket, crippling the spacecraft. Unless NASA found a solution to a problem it had never even imagined, the crew would die in space. Apollo 13 is an outstanding case study on the power of an optimistic outlook. The spacecraft was 200,000 miles from home when one engine quit and they began running out of air. Jim Lovell radioed Mission Control and said these now famous words, "Houston, we have a problem." This unthinkable explosion hadn't entered into the planning of Mission Control. This emergency called for more than just the right scientific answers from space-age technology. The optimistic outlook of everyone involved is what became the real story behind the rescue mission. Back at Mission Control, Flight Director Gene Kranz told his team that he didn't care about the odds or that they had never encountered this problem before. He said they had to believe that the crew was coming home and that failure was not an option. That's the power of outlook. It's our choice whether we have an optimistic or a pessimistic outlook. The Bible says that as a man thinks, so he is. We can choose the way we view life. And the way we view life directly impacts our health and quality of life. Every thought either pulls us toward God or away from God. The good news is we can learn to be positive. And when we do, life improves immediately.
Have you ever wondered why some people seem to get all the breaks? Why she got the promotion or he got the raise? Why life seems to hand some people their dreams on a silver platter? Think about the kids you went to high school with. We all know someone in our class who really surprised us. You know, the kid who seemed to have all the brains but somehow didn't achieve much of anything significant. But then on the other hand, there's the classmate whose success amazes everyone at the class reunion. Though their lives appeared very average in high school, everything just seemed to go their way. Success or happiness is not a matter of good or bad luck. It happens by design. Successful people see life differently. They live with an optimistic outlook. It is important to understand the benefits of optimism because research has revealed that optimism plays a significant role in our overall health, from different rates of cancer to overall immune function. Dr. Seligman, in his book, Learned Optimism, summarizes his many studies on optimism and pessimism by stating that compared to an individual's talent test scores, pessimists end up performing below the potential indicated by their test score results, and optimists are more successful than their scores would indicate they should. He says that the notion of potential without the notion of optimism has very little meaning. By simply choosing an optimistic outlook, we tend to increase our chances for success. That's such an important point. Let me say that again. By choosing an optimistic outlook, we increase our chances for success. Our outlook becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. People who practice the learned habit of maintaining an optimistic outlook approach life differently. To them, destiny isn't a matter of chance, it's a matter of choice. It doesn't matter if you have natural talents and potential, you must reinforce it with positive belief and action. Pessimists often limit their progress toward goals because they don't believe they really have much control over their lives or destiny. They view problems as insurmountable. Pessimists tend to believe the good things that happen to them are just random luck, but take personal responsibility for the bad things that happen to them. People who are optimistic stay in the game and work to make their life a success. They are driven by the deep conviction that their decisions and actions can and will make a difference. They create plans or personal mission statements and manage their actions, adjusting their plans when life throws them an unexpected curve. Keep their attitude positive, always focusing on their goals. It's a process that first begins in the mind. So the next time you find yourself anxious or worried, pause for a moment and pay attention to what you're saying to yourself. We tend to have automatic internal responses to different situations. When something goes wrong, some people tell themselves that things will be better tomorrow, while pessimists tell themselves it's just life and there's nothing you can do about it. We need to develop awareness of these automatic responses, especially the negative ones, and then develop new optimistic ways to interpret what is happening in our lives. People with an optimistic outlook see it, believe it, and seize it. Just as a muddy spring can't produce clear, fresh water, it's impossible for a negative attitude to create positive results. The good thing is that optimism can be learned, and it has an incredibly powerful impact on all areas of your life.
Why don't we take a moment for an exercise called Your Mental Outlook Assessment on page 286. We all might like to think of ourselves as optimists, but are you really one? Search your soul and carefully consider each of your answers. It may change the way you look at this course and your life. Pause the video now and rate your level of optimism. Welcome back now. Where do you fall on the optimism scale? If you're an eternal optimist, great. If not, we can help you with that throughout this lesson and by looking to God for help. Every thought or action either moves us toward a life of unhappiness or towards a life of hope, love, and blessings. With a positive outlook, the riches of life are recognized and our God-given talents are multiplied. A person with an optimistic outlook doesn't accept failure. He or she searches for solutions and remains committed to their plans and goals. Happy and successful people are people who have chosen to live with optimistic attitudes, even though they have their own challenges. By choosing an optimistic outlook, we dramatically increase our chances for success. Do our thoughts shape our life and affect our health? The Bible says, "As we think, so we are." The story about optimistic dreams that Dr. Guthrie is about to read is in the Seminar Personal Study Guide on page 203.
You have heard the parable of the three men laboring in a field of rocks. Each is asked what he is doing. The first man says, "Can't you see? I'm breaking rocks." The second man replies, "Can't you see? I'm earning my salary." The third man answers, his eyes gleaming with enthusiasm, "Can't you see? I'm building a cathedral. This lovely story, which my mother first told me when I was a child, illustrates both the necessity of hard work in realizing a dream as well as the need to keep vision in your mind's eye, even when others don't see or understand it. The money we receive in return for 8 hours of work each day can be spent in any number of ways. The only thing we cannot buy is extra time. So during the minutes we have, I believe it is better to live a dream rather than to simply dream it. The dream is the start of something greater, something that impels us to make daring decisions. And it's true that the person who pursues a dream takes many risks, but the person who does not dream runs risks that are even greater. The optimist takes control, a dream, and moves toward it, takes charge of their life. That's encouraging, isn't it?
A person with an optimistic outlook is the kind of person who celebrates what's right with the world. Having and maintaining this kind of attitude is a powerful life-shaping force. Optimists are filled with peace because of their implicit trust in God. The result is a cheerful spirit that plays a vital role in creating whole person wellness. The Bible says a cheerful heart is good medicine, but a crushed spirit dries up the bones. Proverbs 17:22. What about you? How would you rate your attitude? Do you tend to be anxious or worried? Do you lean towards optimism? In general, do you feel sad, lonely, depressed, or maybe even trapped by life's circumstances? Do you consider yourself to be a negative or positive person? Any negative energy, including fear, anxiety, and depression, can affect you emotionally, physically, spiritually, and socially. The next two exercises are self-tests. One is the depression assessment. And for those of you who may be suffering from generalized anxiety disorder, we hope this test helps you. The depression assessment is on page 278. It deals with your feelings and behavior, and it checks for symptoms of depression. Then, on page 280, you'll find the generalized anxiety disorder test. Understanding anxiety in general may help you or a loved one. You're back. How did it go? Remember, optimism and pessimism are learned behaviors. Part of overcoming anxiety and depression can also be learned, especially when you get help finding a clear vision that's right for you.
Having this positive mindset then enables us to envision the possibilities. And when you have a clear vision, you have meaning and purpose in life, as well as a positive outlook for the future. In fact, a person's positive outlook helps their vision become a reality. Their positive outlook becomes fuel for their vision. Let me explain with one of my favorite illustrations, the immense power of vision. It's the story of Viktor Frankl, a well-known psychiatrist from Austria, who survived the nightmare of the Auschwitz Nazi concentration camp. He found a golden thread of hope. That golden thread of hope was a vision for the future, something he pictured in his mind worth living for. Frankl realized everything could be taken from him by the Nazis except his attitude. That was the one thing he controlled that could not be taken from him. He had a vision of his future. He didn't let the darkness of his experiences through the Holocaust determine how bright his future could be. Regardless of the horrors he was enduring, he focused on how his life could be after the war. He knew that a person with an optimistic outlook identifies something to live for and takes positive action in their daily journey toward making their vision a reality. This hope makes life worth living. Frankl concludes, "It is a peculiarity of man that he can only live by looking to the future. This is his salvation in the most difficult moments of his existence."
Someone once said, "An optimist is the human personification of spring." And it's true. Optimists inspire others with hope and peace. Each of us can become an optimist. A positive outlook is a gift we give ourselves. And one of the many benefits that comes from being optimistic is an increase in the body's cells that fight off disease. Isn't it amazing that something as simple as choosing to be positive boosts your health? Attitude determines how a person views their own health. For instance, consider the following question. For your age, would you say, in general, that your health is excellent, good, fair, poor, or bad? According to several studies done over the past few years, the answer that people give to this simple question is a better predictor of who will live or die over the next 10 years than our in-depth physical examinations and extensive lab tests. This question is a way of asking what our health means to us, what it represents or symbolizes in our thoughts and imagination. It's an example of the vital interplay between meaning and matter. People who perceived their health as excellent were as many as 6 times less likely to die than those who perceived their health to be poor. The results of this study are consistent with the results of 5 other large studies that involved more than 23,000 people, ranging in age from 19 to 94. It's amazing that our own opinion about our health is a better predictor than factors such as physical symptoms and exams, laboratory tests, or behaviors such as cigarette smoking. And not only that, but studies also show that using your mind to imagine the body healing itself can aid the healing process. This is actually referred to as imagery. An example might be imagining your immune system cells attacking cancer cells. Now, in this situation, you're imagining that your body is working in a certain way. You have a perception that it's working in a certain way, and therefore, it does work that way. A literature review on imagery shows that imagery can help people suffering from anxiety, chronic and acute pain, stress, and it can also aid in rehabilitation and problem solving. A Swedish economist and statesman who won the Nobel Peace Prize is well known for saying, "We act in faith and miracles occur." According to Herbert Benson in his book, Timeless Healing, The Power and Biology of Belief, it has been shown that there is a vital link between religious faith and health. The benefits include improved general health, increased survival, reduced alcohol, cigarette, and drug abuse, reduced general anxiety, reduced depression and hostility, reduced blood pressure, and improved quality of life for patients with cancer and heart disease, and improved psychological symptoms. The benefits also include an increase in life and marital satisfaction, and increased well-being, altruism, and self-esteem. It all begins in our minds. Watch your thoughts. They become your words. Watch your words. They become your actions. Watch your actions. They become your habits. Watch your habits. They become your character. Watch your character. It becomes your destiny. Our thoughts do shape who we are, and it's vitally important that we choose carefully what we allow to enter into our minds, because by beholding, we become changed. How you shape your life comes down to the choices you make. This exercise, called the Ben Franklin Ledger, helps you make positive choices by weighing the pros and cons. First, turn to page 285. The Ben Franklin Ledger is known for being simple and effective. Take a few days to list your pros and cons. Then assign a weight to each one using a scale of 1 through 10. If you have a pro and con of equal weight, cross them both out. See more instructions on page 21 of your guide. Next, look at page 284. The measured criteria table helps you compare a number of options. For example, list the criteria you may have for seeking a new job. Do this on the left column. On the top row, list 3 professions. Score using a 1 through 10 scale. Once you add up the scores, you might find the best job for you. See more instructions on page 21. Also on page 284 is the weighted criteria table, where you can weigh criterion as to how important it is compared to the other criteria. Then you can multiply each profession score and come up with the weighted score. Again, see page 21 for more help. We hope this helps you make healthy choices in all aspects of your life. Break time again. Take a quick stretch and don't forget to drink plenty of water today. Please remember to make a note of where you left off using the time displayed on the bottom right. We'll see you a little later. Welcome back. Did you come back with an optimistic outlook? Did you ever think your life would depend on it? Let's look at a couple of amazing studies on optimism versus pessimism. This first study was based on 19,781 person-years of observations from the current vital status of medical patients who completed an optimism-pessimism scale 30 years earlier. Of the 839 patients, 124 were classified as optimistic, 518 as mixed, and 197 as pessimistic. 30 years later, follow-up information was available for 723 of the patients. The researchers' analysis of the survival rate among the 839 medical patients throughout the 30-year period showed that the optimist was associated with a 50% decrease in early death compared to those with a mixed outlook style. Now, in the second study, using the same group of individuals from the first, the optimists reported better physical and mental health. Of the original 839 patients, 447 were not deceased and completed an assessment tool that analyzed their physical and mental functioning 30 years after they were originally classified. The self-reported questionnaire assessed health-related quality of life concepts as perceived by the patient. The optimists reported a decrease in pain and less emotional and physical problems. They reported an increase in physical functioning, general health, vitality, social functioning, and mental health. In short, those with an optimistic style report their life to be healthier, both mentally and physically, than those with the pessimistic style. How do you describe to yourself and others the events that happen in your life? This is called our explanatory style, or how we habitually explain the causes of life events. Dr. Martin Seligman, professor of psychology at the University of Pennsylvania and the author of the national bestseller, Learned Optimism, says, "Your habitual way of explaining bad events, your explanatory style, is more than just the words you mouth when you fail. It's a habit of thought, learned in childhood and adolescence. Your explanatory style stems directly from your view of your place in the world, whether you think you're valuable and deserving or worthless and hopeless. It's the hallmark of whether you're an optimist or a pessimist." Explanatory style has three components: permanence, pervasiveness, and personalization. The first, permanence, deals with time, how long something will last. The second, pervasiveness, is about space. Will something affect a specific area of my life, or will it affect all of my life? And finally, personalization. That involves blaming ourselves when bad things happen. That will control how you feel about yourself. However, the first two, pervasiveness and permanence, are the most important dimensions. They control what you do, meaning how long you are helpless and in what situations. Someone with a pessimistic outlook tends to view their personal success as the result of what others did or because they got lucky. They tend to view their failures as being caused by personal faults. In a crisis situation, a pessimist tends to see overwhelming obstacles, believing they'll get the best of him. Overall, pessimists feel that they don't have control over the events of their lives. When a person has an optimistic outlook, they tend to view success as a result of personal effort and failure as the result of others or bad luck. A crisis is viewed as a temporary challenge that can be overcome and that something good will come from it. Bottom line, optimists feel as though they have control over their lives. Dr. Seligman states in his book, Learned Optimism, that becoming an optimist consists not of learning to be more selfish and self-assertive, but simply by learning a set of skills or how to talk to yourself when you suffer a personal defeat. Seligman did a longitudinal study on school children. This is a study over a long period of time, and those who scored the highest for optimism stayed non-depressed, or if they did get depressed, recovered rapidly. On the other hand, pessimists were the most likely to get and stay depressed. Seligman also found through his research that high scores for optimism are predictive of excellence in many areas, from sports to life insurance sales. This finding saved Metropolitan Life millions of dollars in personnel selection. They hired optimists. He also found that college freshmen who rose to the challenges of their first year and did much better than their talent levels may have suggested they would were optimists when they entered. Those who performed much worse than might be expected because of their GPA, SAT, or achievement tests had entered their freshman year as pessimists. To summarize these studies, Dr. Seligman stated in his book, Learned Optimism, that over and above their talent test scores, we repeatedly find that pessimists drop below their potential and optimists exceed it. He says, I've come to think that the notion of potential without the notion of optimism has very little meaning. The great news here is that Dr. Seligman and others have found that we can change our explanatory style or outlook on life. We can become optimistic, and in doing so, we can avoid or recover from one of the nation's leading causes of disability, depression. By the way, you can find more material on becoming optimistic in the supplemental material at the end of the Outlook presentation section or your personal study guide. The power is ours, to be optimists or pessimists. Pessimism predicts who will get depressed, stay depressed, and relapse into depression after therapy. Who wants that kind of life when we can choose a different path, one that fills our lives with joy, happiness, and much less pain? Pessimism breeds depression. Let's see how being depressed impacts our healthcare costs. This graph presents the median healthcare costs of patients with significant depression symptoms and the costs of patients without depression. This study of older adults found that patients with significant depression symptoms had total healthcare costs that were roughly 50% more than those without symptoms. This increase was seen in every component of healthcare costs and was not accounted for by an increase in the cost of the mental health care itself. This held true even after adjusting for age, gender, and the severity of chronic medical illness. Depression increases healthcare costs overall. Participants in this study included 2,558 people who were older than 65 years of age. Their depression symptoms were common and persistent. Data on the total cost of medical services were obtained from the cost accounting system of the HMO that the individuals used. These findings are of significance because by the year 2040, persons older than 65 years of age are projected to make up 21% of the population and consume almost half of the nation's healthcare resources. Now, this particular study looked at how depression affects survival after surgery. In this case, 817 patients were assessed for depression the day prior to coronary artery bypass surgery, and then again 6 months later. It also included a follow-up for up to 12 years. In the first column, you see the risk of dying for those who had never been depressed. The next column shows those who had remittent depression, which means that they had been depressed, but were not at the time of assessment. The third includes those with a new onset of depression. And the last column shows the risk of those with persistent depression. The study found that despite the many advances in surgical and medical management of patients after coronary artery bypass surgery, depression is an important independent predictor of death after the surgery. This association remained after controlling for measures of disease severity, age, gender, number of grafts, diabetes, smoking, and previous myocardial infarction. Patients with moderate to severe depression prior to their surgery or 6 months afterward had a risk more than 2 times higher than non-depressed patients. It's interesting to note that those who were depressed before surgery but were able to get rid of their depression were at no greater risk of dying than those who were never depressed. If we choose to focus on the negative in life, we tend to have worries and fears. Worry is unhealthy. It's illustrated in a 20-year study of over 1,700 people, looking at the connection between worry and heart attack. As the level of worry went up, so did the relative risk of heart attack. Those with a moderate level of worry had almost twice the risk, while those with a high level of worry had 2.5 times the risk of a heart attack. That is a 250% increase. Now, the good news about depression is that it can be reliably diagnosed and treated. Treatment can improve the quality and satisfaction with care, health outcomes, functioning, economic productivity, and household wealth. Cognitive therapy is helpful in treating depression. It works by making people more optimistic. It prevents the relapse of depression because people acquire a skill that they can use again and again without relying on drugs or doctors. Experts say that drugs relieve depression, but only temporarily. Drugs fail to change the underlying pessimism, which is the root of the problem. Cognitive therapy works because it teaches people to be optimistic. Here, then, are 4 things that can effectively treat depression: humor, vision, hope, and gratitude. Let's take a look at humor first. The arrival of a good clown exercises a more beneficial influence upon the health of a town than the arrival of 20 asses laden with drugs. Dr. Sydenham is considered by historians to be the British Hippocrates. He attributed greater healing powers to a good clown than to all available drugs. The amazing thing is that some of the most sophisticated research being done today by some of the nation's most skilled scientists is proving that the good doctor may have been right after all. A good hearty laugh and all the positive emotions that go along with it may do more to promote health and prevent disease than a medicine cabinet full of drugs. Norman Cousins, former editor of the Saturday Review and a member of the UCLA medical faculty, intrigued the medical community by overcoming typically fatal conditions. One was a massive heart attack, and the other, an advanced case of a degenerative spinal disease. Cousins did what his physicians prescribed each time, but also took in vast doses of positive emotions and laughter. According to Cousins himself, he was healed, not only by the miracle of modern medicine, but also by the healing emotions of hope, love, confidence, faith, and a tremendous will to live. He is convinced that emotions play a profound part in bringing on disease and helping fight it. And he's not the only one with this belief. Specialists in psychophysiological medicine estimate that possibly as much as 90% of all the problems with our health can be traced, at least in part, to the influence of our emotions. Laughter is good for our outlook and heart. Researchers found that laughter may help a person who has already had a heart attack. In this study, 24 cardiac rehabilitation patients watched 30-minute funny videos each day for a year. During the same year, other cardiac patients didn't watch such videos. In those who watched the videos, only 2 had subsequent heart attacks, compared to 10 in the other group. This is the 2nd slide of the same study we just looked at. Now, this slide is a graphic illustration of what happened with the cortisol levels of the experimental and control groups. For this study, the experimental group watched a 60-minute humor video. The control subject had a relatively quiet time with neutral stimuli. As you can see on the slide, both groups started with the same level of cortisol, But as time elapsed, those who were laughing decreased their cortisol levels significantly more. Laughter is good for us. Adults average 15 laughs a day. Children laugh about 400 times a day. Somewhere between childhood and adulthood, we lose 385 laughs a day. We all need to make a conscious choice to see the brighter side of life and laugh more often. For those times, though, when we find ourselves in darker and more challenging situations, there is another powerful tool we can use to remain optimistic: hope. Let's take a few minutes to consider the powerful effects that hope can have on our health and well-being.
Another habit we must practice to enjoy a satisfying life is hope. Having hope and a vision inspired sixth graders in an elementary school in Harlem, New York. Eugene Lang, a successful self-made millionaire, had graduated from this school and was invited back to speak at the school's commencement service for the sixth grade 1981 graduating class of 52 students. As he was speaking, he realized that he just wasn't getting through to his audience. He decided to put his notes aside and he began to talk about Martin Luther King Jr.'s "I Have a Dream" speech. He told the students that everyone had to have a dream if they wanted their life to go somewhere positive. He emphasized the value of education and going to college, but then realized that most of them probably wouldn't be able to afford it. Mr. Lang then made a snap decision. He said, "Don't think for a minute that you can't go to college, because you can." And he promised to pay the college tuition for every sixth grader who was graduating that day who would go on to graduate from high school. This was the first time many of the students felt hopeful about the future. They began to develop a vision for their life. One student said, "I had something to look forward to, something waiting for me. It was a golden feeling." Mr. Lang knew that money alone wasn't the answer. He realized it would take a lot of work, and he helped create a support structure of teachers, counselors, and community who would work with the students to help them accomplish their vision for their lives. School statistics predicted that of the 52 sixth graders graduating that day, only 25% would graduate from high school. And of those 25%, almost none would go to college. But because of Mr. Lang's vision and challenge, 48 of the 52 sixth graders graduated from high school and 40 attended college. That's the power of a vision that inspires hope. God has given us the opportunity to choose our future. He has come to us as Eugene Lang came to those sixth graders with his vision that we become happy, healthy, and productive individuals, not only here, but also in the hereafter. He demonstrated just how much he loves us. He not only inspires us with hope of a pleasant future, but also provides us with the support structure necessary for our success. Any of us who are willing to take advantage of his offer can do so. It is a privilege that can't be taken from us. We can ignore it, but it won't be taken away. Our choice shapes our actions and reactions, impacting our destiny. As has often been said, whether we believe we can or we can't, either way, we're right. So why not believe and act in hope? The Bible says in Romans 8:24 that we are saved by hope. In this text, the word "saved" is translated from Greek "sozo" and includes the concept of being healed from disease as well. What an interesting concept, to be saved and healed by hope. What effect does hope have on health and well-being? The Western Journal of Medicine published a story about a doctor who overheard two oncologists comparing the results they had with their treatment of cancer patients. Both used the same drugs, dosage, and criteria, but one success rate was 22%, the other was 74%. They each used a drug combination of etoposide, platinol, Oncovin, and hydroxyurea, commonly referred to as EPO, EPOH. The oncologist with the 22% success rate told his patients he was giving them EPO. But the oncologist with the 74% success rate told his patients he was giving them HOPE, H-O-P-E, and emphasized how this medicine gave them a good chance for survival. HOPE has an incredible effect on how well a patient recovers. Not having hope, hopelessness, has an equally significant impact on a patient's recovery, for the worse. For example, studies show that hopelessness is a strong, independent predictor of cardiovascular disease, morbidity, and mortality. HOPE has an incredible effect on how we live our lives as well. Living without hope, hopelessness, has a significant impact on the quality of our lives, both here and into eternity. God has given us strong evidence of His care and vision for us. He has provided us with the support structure and resources we need. Simply believing our situation is hopeful affects the outcome. We can instantly improve our life by being more hopeful. We can enjoy superior results by simply expecting the best and trusting the one who loves us to provide what we need for success. Hopefulness is a gift. Hopefulness is a choice. With practice, hopefulness can become a habit.
Hope is one of God's gifts for energizing the human spirit. Norman Cousins is possibly best known for what he called the biology of hope. He told the story of physician William Buchholz, as reported in the Western Journal of Medicine. As Buchholz was eating breakfast one morning, he overheard two oncologists discussing papers they were going to present that day at the National Meeting of the American Society of Clinical Oncology. One of the physicians complained bitterly, "You know, Bob, I don't get it. We use the same drugs, same dosage, same schedule, and the same entry criteria. Yet I only get a 22% response rate while you get 74%. That's unheard of for metastatic lung cancer. How do you do it?" The other physician responded, "You're right. We're both using etoposide, platinol, oncovin, and hydroxyurea. But you call yours EPO, E-P-O-H. I tell my patients I'm giving them hope, H-O-P-E. Sure. I tell them it's experimental, and we do go over the long list of side effects together, but I emphasize that we have a chance." As dismal as those statistics are for non-small cell, there are always a few percent who do really well. Hope encourages us to work toward a better situation. This can happen even in the face of a chronic or terminal illness. In a study of adults with Parkinson's disease, those who had the most hope were also those who engaged in the most health-promoting behaviors. These behaviors included physical activity, better nutrition, spiritual growth, and interpersonal relations. On the other hand, hopelessness is devastating. Hopelessness is defined as a negative expectation about oneself and the future. Hopelessness has been identified as a strong, independent predictor of cardiovascular disease and mortality in the study presented on this slide, which included 2,428 men ages 42 to 60. Men who reported high levels of hopelessness at the beginning of the study had faster progression of carotid atherosclerosis than the men who reported low to moderate levels of hopelessness. Also revealed was an interaction between the amount of hopelessness and the initial amount of atherosclerosis. The progression of the disease was greatest among men reporting high levels of hopelessness at both the beginning of the study and its end. Another interesting fact from this study was that highly hopeless men had a threefold risk increase of death from violence or injury when compared with the reference group. The power of hope is closely linked to the power of belief, which we touched on briefly earlier in the presentation. In 1994, the prestigious Journal of the American Medical Association printed a review on pain medications and surgery over the previous 25-plus years. It concluded, "The quality of interaction between the patient and the physician can be extremely influential in patient outcomes, and in some, perhaps many cases, patient and provider expectations and interactions may be more important than the specific treatments. Our faith, hope, perceptions, and beliefs are indeed powerful. But how powerful? Perhaps the best-known example of the power of the mind to create physical changes in the body is found in what science terms the placebo effect. A placebo is defined as a treatment or aspect of a treatment that does not have a specific action on a patient's symptom or disease. Here are some examples of how powerful the placebo effect can be. Men who were told they were receiving a drug that increased hair growth did indeed experience growth when the substance was only a placebo. In another case, children were given a drug and told it would increase their lung capacity. And it did, despite being a placebo. Women were given a placebo that they were told would cure them of their nausea and vomiting. And it did. But amazingly enough, the placebo used was Ipecac, a drug traditionally used to induce vomiting. It only makes sense that if our thoughts and beliefs can influence us positively, then they can affect us negatively as well. In fact, the nocebo effect is the causation of sickness or death by expectations of sickness and death and by emotional states. People commonly equate the nocebo effect with the concept of voodoo. There is, however, substantial scientific evidence that our thoughts can negatively affect our health. And here are some examples. Women who believed they were more likely to develop heart disease were more likely to do so than women who believed they were less likely. It's significant to note that the two groups had similar biomedical risk factors. When asthmatic individuals were told that they were taking a drug that would make their breathing difficult, the drug did increase their airway resistance, even though it was composed of a simple saline solution. A harmless look-alike plant that was said to be poison ivy caused rashes in allergic people. And finally, one group of patients in a cancer study were given a completely benign substance but told it was a powerful anti-cancer medicine that caused hair loss. And the patients experienced hair loss. There's something besides our beliefs that fosters an optimistic outlook, and it's this: gratitude. Let's watch this next DVD segment about gratitude's profound healing effects.
Regularly expressing your gratitude also helps you have a positive outlook. Gratitude is a key part of a positive outlook. In your mind, start making a list of things for which you are grateful. It can be people or things. I'm thankful for sunshine and fresh air. I'm thankful for my family and the special people I can always count on. I'm thankful for a place to call home. I'm thankful for a knowledge of a God that cares about me as a person, and I'm thankful for His promise to work all things out for good. That promise puts a silver lining on even the darkest cloud. You should count your blessings. It would be good if you wrote down a list to review and add to every day. It will make it easier to choose to have a positive outlook. Counting your blessings will help you develop thankfulness and gratitude. Each day, tell someone at least one thing you are thankful for. Compliment those around you and tell others you are grateful for them, and they make your life better. When you do this, both of you will feel happier. In a research project on gratitude, people who regularly listed what they were thankful for experienced higher levels of optimism, alertness, enthusiasm, determination, and energy. Grateful people are more empathetic and are considered more helpful and generous by the people in their social networks. Their social involvement leads to better connection with others, leading to greater satisfaction with life. People with a positive outlook don't deny or ignore negative things in their life, but work through them with a hopeful attitude. Optimists count their blessings. Pessimists count their burdens. Being grateful brings joy to your life, and it helps you realize all the good that's around you. It's as simple as counting your blessings. It'll make a world of difference.
This should be an uplifting exercise called Expressing Gratitude on page 198. At the end of each day, jot down what you're thankful for. Make a note to take action to thank that person with words of thanks, a note, email, or letter. Make sure you include the positive impact they make on your life. Pause here and take a look and see if there's anything that happened today you would like to write down. We're glad to see you back. By the end of your first week, do a week in review on how this impacted your life. Let's take a look at more research on gratitude. The effect of a grateful outlook on psychological and physical well-being was researched. People who regularly listed what they were grateful for had many benefits. Those who regularly wrote down what they were grateful for had higher levels of optimism, alertness, enthusiasm, determination, attentiveness, and energy. They were also more likely to help others, exercise more regularly, make more progress toward personal goals, and have a better duration and quality of sleep, and were more likely to feel loved. They also had a greater sense of feeling connected to others. Gratitude encouraged a positive cycle of reciprocal kindness among people. In other words, one act of gratitude leads to another. In the four studies reported about here that were also part of the research project on gratitude and Thanksgiving, researchers examined four areas related to gratefulness. In the area of overall well-being, grateful people reported higher levels of positive emotions, life satisfaction, vitality, optimism, and lower levels of depression and stress. The researchers found that grateful people do not deny problems. They just face them with a different attitude. In the area of materialism, grateful people placed less importance on material goods and were more likely to share their possessions with others. They were less likely to judge success in terms of possessions, and they were less envious of others. Now, let us turn to the last topic of our presentation, vision. What sentence do you see in this string of letters? Opportunity is nowhere, or opportunity is now here? We can choose to live with a positive vision, starting today. Vision gives meaning and purpose for life and a positive outlook for the future. A person's positive outlook helps their vision become a reality. Their optimistic approach fuels their vision. Without having a vision or purpose, life will become vague and very confusing. Vision brings clarity, power, and energy. Viktor Frankl was a psychiatrist from Vienna who lived through the horrors of Auschwitz, a Nazi concentration camp. After the war, he returned to Vienna and wrote the classic book, Man's Search for Meaning, sharing what he learned during his internment. Millions died in the camps, and yet, among those who survived, Viktor Frankl found a common thread, a trait essential to their survival. All of those who made it through had something significant yet to do in their future. And here we see the pattern again, the power of vision of the future to help overcome seemingly insurmountable odds. Frankl writes about how two men were going to commit suicide, something that was common. Their friends literally saved their lives by reminding them of their future. For the one, it was his child whom he adored and was waiting for him in a foreign country. For the other, it was a thing, not a person. This man was a scientist and had written a series of books which still needed to be finished. His work could not be done by anyone else. Once the men were reminded of their responsibilities to their future, they accepted it and wanted to survive. This worked for Frankl himself. He writes about when he was almost in tears from pain due to terrible sores on his feet from wearing torn shoes. He said, "I became disgusted with the state of affairs which compelled me daily and hourly to think of only such trivial things. I forced my thoughts to turn to another subject. Suddenly, I saw myself standing on the platform of a well-lit, warm, and pleasant lecture room. In front of me sat an attentive audience on comfortable upholstered seats. I was giving a lecture on the psychology of the concentration camp. All that oppressed me at that moment became objective, seen and described from the remote viewpoint of science. By this method, I succeeded somehow in rising above the situation, above the sufferings of the moment, and I observed them as if they were already of the past. Frankl's message is clear. It's essential for us to have a positive vision of our future. This is what gives meaning to life. Frankl wrote, "It is a peculiarity of man that he can only live by looking to the future, and this is his salvation in the most difficult moments of his existence." Children are profoundly affected by their vision of the future. One study found that low-performance students have almost no sense of their future. These children believe that the ability to shape their future was in the hands of fate and out of their control. On the other hand, research indicated that successful students had a much greater personal sense of control over their future, and they thought in time horizons of 5 to 10 years out. When identifying successful students, IQ and family background were not key indicators of success. What all successful students shared was a profound and positive vision of their future. The video, "Celebrate What's Right with the World with DeWitt Jones," teaches what a powerful force having a vision can be. In this video, Jones states that for 20 years, I worked for National Geographic, photographing stories all over the globe, creating extraordinary visions. I learned a great deal from these visions about society, about geography, about people. But the vision that most changed my life was not photographic. It was an attitude, a perspective that exists at the core of the geographic, a vision so simple yet so profound, to celebrate what's right with the world. When I was growing up, I used to say, "I won't believe it until I see it." Yet the more I shot photos for National Geographic, the more I realized that I had it backwards. That the way it really works is, I won't see it till I believe it. That's the way life works. And the more I believed, the more I'd see in everything. I started every assignment, every day, every photo, trying to celebrate what was right with a situation rather than what was wrong with it. When I started, I had no idea how powerful that vision would be, how much it would change my life. But vision controls our perception, and our perception becomes our reality. Do you have a vision like that for yourself? A vision that you could put into 6 words, that every morning when you say those words, you say, "Yes, that's why you are doing whatever you're doing." Because when the vision is clear, passion and creativity are there as well. To help you clarify your vision, in this exercise called Values List for My Life, you can find out what is most important to you. The list is on page 282, and it covers a wide array of behaviors, feelings, and values. You may aspire to many of the attributes, and you may want to make improvements on others. Use the scale on the next page to rate your goals. Please pause the video to get started. You're back now. Were you able to put your vision into 6 words, like the National Geographic photographer in the video? Let's see a little more about that kind of optimism.
It was hope, an incredibly positive attitude, and some remarkable vision that eventually brought Apollo 13 back home. You can only imagine the joy and thunderous applause that filled Mission Control. The team had brought the astronauts home alive with their optimistic outlook and positive action. Their determination had accomplished the impossible. They never accepted failure as an option. Add hope to your life and you begin to see things differently. Starting now, we can change how we view the world and experience life. It will become more enjoyable and satisfying the way God intends for us. Here are 4 habits to begin taking charge of our outlook today. Practice optimism. Focus on the positive. Live with vision. Hope. Find the good in every situation. And express gratitude. share at least one thing that you're thankful for with someone every day. Remember, opportunity is everywhere. Believe it, see it, seize it. This is your life, and this is how God wants you to live it. That's Creation Health.
Have you ever asked yourself, "So what's so great about my life?" You will in this next exercise on page 194. This skill builder will help you break the habit of focusing on what goes wrong in your life. It'll help you create a new habit of focusing on the good things that happen to you every day. You'll make notes on a feel-good moment and state your explanation of why you think it happened. Over time, you might realize you're making good things happen more often. Please pause the video and take a look. We're happy to see you back, and we hope you'll stop letting good things in your life slip by without notice. Now, let's finish up this lesson. Let's conclude today's presentation by discovering how we can develop a positive attitude. Start by practicing the following: optimism, living with vision, maintaining hope in all situations, and by expressing gratitude every day. Remember, it begins in our minds. And as we have seen, our thoughts and what we believe about life help create our reality. This slide helps us understand the connections between thoughts and health, but also takes it a step further and shows us how they affect our destiny. Our thoughts do shape who we are, and we need to be careful about what we allow in our minds. It's easier to be optimistic when you remember who you are. You are a person of value. Christ died for you and promises to never leave or forsake you. Remember that you are a child of God. Changing your outlook and maintaining it begins and continues by practicing what we've learned in this presentation. We can gain optimism by praying for peace and hope and reading the Bible, especially the Book of Psalms. One of God's most powerful promises is in Isaiah 41:10. "So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my victorious right hand." We can increase our optimism by practicing forgiveness, releasing memories and pain that weigh us down. A pessimistic outlook can be transformed by vision. Vision gives meaning and purpose. Here are some things to keep in mind. Look for opportunities to improve your attitude. Surround yourself with positive role models. Maintain hope in all situations. Remember that out of the greatest challenges come the greatest accomplishments. Express gratitude every day. Start by thanking God for all His blessings and focus on your family and friends. In our time together, we have shared that indeed, a positive outlook profoundly impacts our ability to achieve good health. The awesome thing is that we can choose our outlook and attitude. We choose it every day, hundreds of times over. Sometimes we're very conscious of it. Other times, we do things out of habit and don't think much about it at all. We choose it in the little things and the big things, and each one of those choices is important. The mind and body are intimately connected. The mind is indeed the control center of our body. So, what do you see? Opportunity is now here or nowhere. It is or isn't, depending on how you choose to look at it. Let's choose to live with an optimistic outlook, one that fills our soul with hope, vision, and gratitude. This is Creation Health. Your tips for success start on page 201, where you can review power tips on how to improve your outlook on life. And on page 202, you can learn the Optimist Creed by heart. We'll close with some insight from Dr. Des Cummings, Jr. as he answers the frequently asked question, How does my outlook affect my future?
Every letter in the creation acronym is vital. I want to talk to you about the letter O, outlook. One day I was driving down the road, really feeling pretty sad about the fact that I was aging and reaching a milestone in my aging direction. Then I turned on the radio, and instead of feeling sorry for myself, I realized my problem was my outlook. They were interviewing an 89-year-old woman who was president of AARP. The interviewer asked her first question, "Why are you wearing braces on your teeth?" She responded with, "I need to get them straightened." He was flustered and said, no, I meant at your age, why did you choose to wear braces at age 89? She said, "I've been more active lately socially and I want to look my best." Immediately, I responded by beginning to laugh at myself. I was already accepting aging as a destination. She refused to do it. I changed my outlook. I went home and brightened my teeth, went to work, and decided to live instead of older, live bolder. Creation Health can change your life. The DVDs and stories we have to share with you can help you change the outlook on whatever you need to do to make your attitude for the future and your life in the present eternal.
This concludes our Creation Health training on the topic of outlook. As we proceed on to the next lessons, we'll continue to discuss the remaining principles in the Creation acronym. Congratulations! You're well on your way to becoming a certified Creation Health graduate. Good luck on the quiz.